let's talk about what do you think the story is today or this week about SARS-CoV-2? Where are you at right now?
I think the story is a storyline that we exactly predicted. We have watched this movie and its ending three previous times. We are now replaying the movie for the fourth time, the fourth surge in the US. This was entirely predictable. I've talked about this to the media for the last couple of months. You can count the number of days since July 4th celebrations, the lifting of restrictions, and the large amount of travel that's happening in association with a variant that is more contagious than anything we've seen with coronavirus and relatively low immunization levels. This is no surprise at all.
Do you know why Delta is more transmissible? There was a confusion about this. Is there more volume of Delta in the clouds we breathe? Is it just
So what's actually happening is that this particular virus has mutations that allow it to bind very tightly to the receptors that sit on the surface of our cells, allowing the virus to infect us more easily and multiplying in such a manner that the viral loads are roughly four times higher than it with the original virus. That's why when you look back a year and we say, gee, kids and adolescents really weren't affected by this, that is no longer true. The viral titers here are high enough that we're seeing an increase. This last week, for example, there were 23,000 new infections in children in the US. So people are operating on very outdated information. They are operating on misinformation and disinformation that is materially harming them. Why do I say that? We have, you may have seen some of the calculations this morning. We have lost about 1.5 years of life to the US population life expectancy. For Blacks, even higher, 2.9. The last time this happened was the middle of World War II. And what did we call that? A war. And we pretend as if the pandemic is over because we're emotionally tired of it. We don't want to keep wearing a mask or living under these restrictions. We don't want to have to get a vaccine, but it is to our harm not to.
Can you tell me the very latest on the efficacies of the J&J, Pfizer, and Moderna vaccines specific to Delta?
So all three of them are extraordinarily effective in preventing death, severe disease, even against the Delta variant. Now, what is clear is that there does appear to be a decrease in efficacy against the Delta variant for symptomatic disease with the two adenovirus vectored vaccines, J&J and AstraZeneca. There's still some controversy about that. We need more data around that, but we do know that two doses of the mRNA vaccines are extraordinarily effective. But let me make one really clear point here.
Yeah.
The longer we go with large numbers of people getting vaccinated, the greater and greater the risk that a new variant will develop that will evade vaccine-induced immunity. So we are our own worst enemies here.
You're saying if not enough people get the vaccine, we're going to roll the dice all over again.
Yes, that's very clear.
That should scare people.
Well, what I hope it does is by hearing a clear declaration of the facts of where we are, that it might motivate people to reconsider. Look, as I often ask people who are hesitant or have rejected it, I say, well, you know, how many years have you studied coronaviruses? Well, I have studied RNA respiratory viruses for 40 years. That this is not a surprise to those of us that study these viruses. This is what these viruses do. And to pretend otherwise is to simply be naive, frankly.
I see discrepancy in recommendations of what people who got the J&J shot should do next. Dr. Vin Gupta out in Washington said that he would recommend if you got a J&J that you should get on the mRNA vaccine right away. The CDC and the FDA aren't saying that. What are you saying?
So this does cause confusion. So the official recommendations are at this point, because of lack of data on this fine point that you're raising, is to not get a second dose at this point. Now, what the other physician you're mentioning is doing is extrapolating from the data we do have and saying, my guess is that the best thing to do would be to get a second dose. We're not there yet. I will not be surprised if we end up there, but we don't have the data to be able to tell people that. Now, one close approximation, the other adenovirus vaccine, AstraZeneca, very clear that two doses is better than one.
Someone else whose mother is in her late 80s, she has diabetes. She's a beautiful target for COVID-19.
Sure.
Hasn't received it yet. Everyone in her immediate family and area do not trust the vaccine and believe it's poison, et cetera. What do you, one of the world's leading experts on infectious diseases, have to say to people like that?
I would say, number one, I would plead with them to get the vaccine, not only for their own safety, but for the safety of their mother. Number two, the mother must be vaccinated. I would do everything in my power to show her the data and hopefully convince her that she should indeed make the decision to get vaccinated. And number two, they're wearing masks. The other thing that I would say is, when you have rejected the reasons, show me your science-based reasons for rejecting it. Feelings are not a way in which to make life and death decision. What do the data show? And I'll be very, very blunt as a vaccinologist. No vaccine is 100% effective. No vaccine is 100% safe. No human product is 100% effective and 100% safe. Where wisdom resides is in saying, do I want to take this teeny risk of the vaccine or this huge risk of the viral infection?
Oh, there was one other question.
Yeah.
What do you foresee in the crystal ball regarding masks and the general public in the next couple months?
Yeah, it's really unfortunate, Chris, that masks have become a symbol of anything other than wisdom for protecting yourself against an infectious pathogen. It has been conflated with politics, economics, religion. It is none of those. It is a medical issue. I think that what people in the know will be doing is wearing a mask. Here at Mayo Clinic, I'm in my private office right now, but otherwise, I'm in this mask all day long, okay? And then I walk outside of the Mayo Clinic and say, go to the grocery store, nobody's in a mask. What sense does that make? So you're going to see people who are knowledgeable about this wearing masks and protecting their lives. You're going to see people who are not knowledgeable and not vaccinated getting hospitalized, sick, and dying.
You know, to that point real quick, like, so I've done a lot of research on this and we've been on it for year and a half. And I'm comfortable now not wearing a mask. I know the risks it possesses, but I got two shots of Pfizer, plus I had COVID-19 back in November. So I have a lot of immunity. And I understand now that I'm taking in and exchanging particles with people, and that can be dangerous in itself. But I'm also, like you said, I'm very tired of that exercise.
Sure.
And given the 99% rate of efficacy in the vaccine and et cetera, I feel safer. Should I not?
No, I think, you know, you're young and you look healthy and everything. So, you know, that's not an unreasonable line of thinking. But let me mention one other factor that when I bring it up is so much not a part of our culture that it shocks people. Mm. And that is to say, it's not just about you. So if you ever see me indoors in another venue, I will be in a mask. And what I'm saying is, it's not just about me. I care about you. And I know that even being doubly vaccinated, I could get asymptomatic infection and unknowingly spread it to somebody who's immunocompromised, who's elderly, who didn't respond to the vaccine. And we do see some of those. And I'm trying to protect them and be a role model for that. The way I put it is, and it's really unfortunate, in the US, we are a me culture. Other cultures, particularly in Asia, who wear masks are a we culture.